Peace, everybody. Just seeing if I'm recording. This is Queen Ifama. I am the Truth Seeker. And I wanted to do a video today because I've been doing a lot of research, studying, thinking, contemplating, particularly on issues that Brother C and I have discussed. And one of those is, about the male and female. And we like to call it a gender war. But I don't call it a gender war. I call it a role defining conflict because things have shifted. And so I just got through eating a salad. I want to make sure I ain't got no salad on my teeth. Excuse me. It is my lunch hour. Okay. So anyway, because you know you got a green lettuce on your teeth. That is spinach, rather. And people see that on the video. And I ain't going to redo the video for no lettuce. So I have to make the, or spinach. So I have to make sure that is gone. But anyway, he and I have been, he's been sharing videos with me about, the male role. I think that the role of the male and the female has drastically changed in the society. And I think there's a lot of confusion, and if I were to just go on the written documentation, like the written stuff that I read about, male and female, the male and female dynamic. And then I also always have to take in the fact that I was abused by a male. And I've seen men do terrible things, which, made me kind of biased. So I have to always check my biases and my prejudices when it deals with talking about men and what men do, okay? But I think what I'm fortunate in a way is that I've been able to look at women do, what women do, and, not contrast them, but hold them both up, you understand? And not weigh one ability to create havoc any more or weigh it any less than the others. And so I've been looking at both the male and the female and the roles that some of them play, and also how things become stereotyped in the society through the media and things like that, through constant dialogue. Pull my chair around. Through constant dialogue and things like that. So, I've been very fortunate to be able to, I hope, be able to look at this whole situation with a clear eye, and take in consideration every time I make an assessment of my own biases based on my own experience, and things that I've seen. So, it gets a little hairy because you kind of lean toward some of the things that have happened, but what I try to do is avoid using that as a blanket for all males or all females. But one book that the brother exposed me to, and had it not been for him, I probably wouldn't have never sought out reading material outside of the internet for this particular subject. But I think it's really important. And the title of the book is called The Disposible Man. It's a really good book. And it's by Michael Gilbert. But I'm going to be honest with you, okay? I got 5 bookshelves full of books. And if I told you that I read all those books cover to cover, I'd be telling you a damn lie, okay? But I have read all of the books. And I'm going to tell you how I do it, just to let you know how I read this book. And I found this to work for me, okay? Because I get the whole gist. What I do when I open up a book, I open up the book. Sometimes I read the introduction. Like, here's the introduction to the book. I read the introduction to the book. I read the dedication to the book. I read the preface to the book. And I also read the first chapter in a book. Then I go all the way to the end of the book. This is just to show you guys how I, read a book. I go to the last chapter. In this book, the last chapter is Darwin's Conundrum. You go to the last, then I go to the last chapter of the book. If it has if it has acknowledgments, I read the acknowledgments, because that way you can find what influenced the author. And then I read further readings, you know, things where they got their shit from. I read that. And then I read the index and all the references in the book. And that's basically how I read a book. Anything else I need to know about, because through the index, you'll see a title or something in the index. And let me go read about that. And so that's inside the book. But basically for me, I just read what I told you in the book. And then I go back and I read the last chapter of the book. Then I read all the stuff after the last chapter of the book. That way I kind of get a good grip of the book. And so that's why I'm suggesting this book, just based on that. The Disposable Male. Because it seems to me that in today's society, men don't know their roles clearly anymore. You know, it was a time when men knew who they were. They were the protector, the provider. And then something, you know, I always forget that third one, but it's three things. I always forget that third one when I do a video. But men knew their roles, and men who didn't do that, you know, they were castigated in the society, though not totally, you know what I'm saying? Because they were given, you know, accolades as being pimps or players, or some of them, you know, some of them like that. But, you know, people who come from, you know, different backgrounds would classify people as bums who wasn't taking care of their families or things like that. But now, you know, since the feminist movement, men are confused as to what their roles are, you know, because the woman's role has definitely changed. So, you know, men are now struggling to figure out where they fit in the society. I mean, in general. But I'm gonna tell you what I see, because if I relied on everything I read about men and what they do, and listening to that dialogue that I read on YouTube, and taking that as a summation of what men are, I'd be really fucked up and really saying fuck men right now. You know what I'm saying? But because I don't do that, and I look more with my eyes at what I see in my community, in the society that I live in, what I'm looking at, people, is this. I work in a school building, you know, not a school per se, but the administration building. I'm going to tell you, I have seen more young men coming in here with their children, seeking their education, changing their schools, coming to see what's wrong with them, things like that. I've seen more of that lately than I've seen anywhere. Men carrying those little car, you know, those little carriers that you strap your baby in the car with and stuff like that. I've seen more men than I've ever seen this school year doing that. Not only that, I've seen more men in the grocery stores shopping by themselves or with their children, without a wife, without their wife around or mates around. Then I've also seen, now this is real talk, y'all. This is my observation in the community that I live in, okay? I've seen more men, you know, shopping with their kids, doing things with their children. I see more men out in the street with their children, pushing strollers with their children, looking quite comfortable, by the way, with their, you know, interacting with their children. I'm seeing more of that happening more and more every day. Now, you know, there is, a struggle with men and their ideal of manhood and what a man is supposed to do. And I think that is what needs more clarity in the society, because I think that women really have defined their roles. Either they're going to be housewives or they're going to be career women, one or the other. You know what I'm saying? But for a man, it's a struggle, because a man is defined by the things that he does. And now we have to shift. What is it that men do that make them a man? Because as I said before, it was the provider, the protector. I cannot think of that. I can't never think of that last one. But it's three main things. You know what I'm saying? He's a provider, a protector. Golly, I can't think of it. You see, I know it's not, I don't know, donor. I don't know. But it's a third one, right? That's really important, and I can't never remember it, which says something. And that says something else as far as my psychology is concerned, because it's that one thing that I can't never remember, which I'm going to try to go back and find. And I'll share with you guys once I find it and be able to relay it back to you. But if you've watched my videos for a while, you'll know I never remember that, okay? But anyway, because now men don't have to provide for women totally. And it's obvious, particularly in the Black community, that the Black man has not been a protector per se, you know, of Black women. I mean, other races have always been able to have their way with the Black woman. So it's not about protection of the Black woman anymore. And I think that protection is, and I just want to put this on record too. And I say that about the Black man not being to protect the woman, and I'm talking about physically, but there are other ways that Black men that can protect women emotionally or spiritually that, you know, that's not physical. So when we think of protection, we think of physical protection. I know that's what I was thinking of, but there are a lot of other ways that men protect women. Okay. So I just wanted to put that on record, that it's not that, you know, the physical part of protection is another aspect of protection, other aspects of protection that men supply for women. And not only that, women can supply protection to men as well in the realm of psychological and emotional and spiritual protection for their mate and their families as well. I mean, everybody has an input into the psychological, emotional, spiritual well-being of every member of the family, and we protect that. So we all can be a protector. That shouldn't solely fall on the male just basically because he has a physical strength. That's when we're talking about physical protection. So, you know, I've learned a lot talking to Brother C. As a matter of fact, he's, helped me re-examine a lot of the things that I had formed in my brain about relationships, you know, with men. And like I said, a lot of times, mine was going on my experiences with men, which has not always been positive. And what I've read and what I see, you know, through the media, as well as through print, reading comments on, you know, mediums such as Facebook, YouTube, etc., etc. Make sure my battery's not going out. Okay. You know, YouTube, etc., etc. Just going by that. But I started really paying attention to what I was seeing that I hadn't paid attention to before. And like I said, I've been on this planet for 60 years. So that means that in my adulthood, which I would count to really being an adult at 30, because I'm not going to even count my 20s as adulthood, okay? Because I was doing some real juvenile shit in my 20s, all right? As far as I'm concerned. But I would say that I start, you know, really growing up when I got 30 years old, taking on responsibilities, you know, for myself as well as someone else when I got in my 30s. So as I start watching, you know, the world, I could look back, particularly from this point to my 30s. You know, not even a point in reference of when I was molested or anything like that in my childhood. I'm talking about from when I got 30 years old and started being responsible and things like that. And I start looking at, you know, I can look back now at that, at those eras and see a change, a shift in the dynamics between men and women. And I also can see the conflict. And now I'm kind of understanding why that conflict is. I think that we all experience confined only to the lock and key mechanism of sex. I think this is a really good book. You know, because one of the questions asked in the book is, why are men sexually oriented and driven toward resource acquisition while most women seek committed relationships? Why is that? And I think it's because it's how the society, the culture in the society is designed. But see, there are things that are going against culture, and culture is shifting as culture does throughout the human experience. is that we've changed things, which changed our culture. So I see a shift. And like I said, I want to thank Brother C for, you know, having this discussion with me, hipping me to this book, as well as I got that other book too, some about misogyny, something about misogyny, or something. But what the book is about, it's about this growing misandric, not misogyny. But I've been looking at misogyny now. But now I'm looking at misandry. So I got another book about misandry and how this whole culture is really a man-hating culture. I mean, everything you see or read about men is generally downgrading men. You know what I'm saying? I mean, like, and I think, I don't know, brother, if that was Brother C who brought this out, but when you look at some of the characters on TV, the man is always stupid. The man is dumb. He's always doing dumb stuff. He's always a cockhound. He's always just focused on sex. I mean, it's like men have nothing else on their minds but that. And that is what we get in the society. Unfortunately, men think the same way. You know, just like women think that their bodies or how they look is the end all of for a relationship. You know, being attracted. And I know, I understand, you know, being attracted to somebody, you first see how they look. You know, which is why a lot of us make a lot of mistakes with a lot of people, is because we go by how they look and not how they really are, which is why it's important to get to know people. But back to this book right here. I cannot think of that other book, but it had something to do with Miss Sandry. But the whole thing is all about, you know, this general societal perpetuation of men, you know, not being as smart, they just depicted, you know, in a real negative way. And that's why Brother was saying, you know, in his video about, you know, how men built skyscrapers and all that stuff. But then again, brother, like I said, it's only because women were locked out of that industry. So, you know, it was all male industry. Women couldn't get into it until recently. So I think that's basically why that is. And you still have resistance of men from women being in some, you know, of these industries. That's why when women put on them uniforms, they kind of look masculine in those damn uniforms, because they ain't cut for women. They're cut for men. But anyway, I digress. But anyway, this is a good book called The Disposable Male. Like I said in my initial part of this video, this is how I read the book. I ain't been all inside the book. I don't need to go inside the book unless I see something that I want to, you know, read. Like I go, like I told you, I go in the index and I see a subject in the index that I want to go read about. I'll go into the inside of the book. But, you know, reading the first part of the book and the last part of the book, it wrapped the whole book. Oh, yeah. And you got to read the back part of the book, too. So it really wrapped it up for me. So I really appreciate Brother C. I appreciate you. Hey, big ups to you for exposing me to this book, because I'd have never went looking for it. And also the other book, I cannot think of the name of it, but it has something to do with misandry. Okay, I'm really anxious to get off into that. I haven't gotten off into that book yet. But I think that we need to really start rethinking how we think about the male-female dynamic. And that a lot of times our own personal experiences, the things that we see, can cloud our better judgment. You know, because I think that what males are missing, have lacked, is the rite of passage. A very distinct rite of passage. Not, you know, men have been conditioned to that their rite of passage is the first piece of pussy that they get. Men have not valued their own penises. They've been encouraged to stick it anywhere in the society that they can. You know what I'm saying? So I think that, you know, we really have to rethink this whole male-female dynamic on the planet in the 21st century, because this is not the 19th century. It's past the 20th century. We are now in the 21st century and things are completely different. You know, and like I said, a lot of people aren't old enough to be able to look back, you know, and if they're looking back, they're looking back as a child. But I'm looking back as a grown person. I mean, grown person. I get my 30s. I'm looking back to 30 years, okay? And where we were in the society. You know, and how I've seen things change in the society as far as relationships are concerned, and how I've seen the resistance, and how I've recognized my own biases and prejudices against men because of what men have done to me and what I have seen men do to other people. And then on the flip side of that, I had to open my other eye to see what women have done. What women have done to me and what women have done to other people. So, you know, I'm trying to be a little bit more open and balanced here. Because we always talk about balance. Well, let's really talk about balance. So with that said, this is Queen Ifama. I am the truth seeker. And I hope y'all got some understanding out that video, because I just did it off the rip. But I wanted to really talk about the disposable man. So with that said, I'm out. Peace, everybody.